So lay down your hurt, lay down your heart, come as you are.
Good morning.
Morning.
It's good to see you all here this morning. Thank you for coming. A few announcements for you today. First, I want to remind you all that there will be no adult class at 11 o'clock this Sunday for the Transform series. Also, the next caregiver support gathering will be Tuesday, October 19th at 7 p.m. in the East Wing classrooms. Something fun coming up, we have a Kids and Youth Fall Festival on Saturday, October 23rd. And there will be pumpkin painting and games and a scavenger hunt. And if you have any questions about that, you can contact either me or Tanny. And announcement from our outreach ministry. So our outreach ministry team want to give you an opportunity to serve children in our community. Glens Valley Elementary has reached out to the church in hopes of doing some tutoring in school. And so they'll be working with, volunteers will be working with second, third, and fourth graders on Tuesdays from 10:15 a.m. to 12 p.m. starting October 26th. And the sign up for that is in the Welcome Center. Our verse for this morning comes from Isaiah chapter 63, starting in verse 7. It says, I will recount the steadfast love of the Lord, the praises of the Lord, according to all that the Lord has granted us, and the great goodness to the house of Israel, that he has granted them according to his compassion, according to the abundance of his steadfast love. For he said, surely they are my people, children who will not deal falsely. And he became their savior. And in all their affliction, he was afflicted. And the angel of his presence saved them. In his love and in his pity, he redeemed them. And he lifted them up and carried them all the days of old. But they rebelled and grieved his Holy Spirit. Therefore, he turned to be their enemy and himself fought against them. Let's pray together this morning. Lord Jesus, we thank you again for the lovely weather you've given to us this weekend. Thank you for this church and how dedicated they are to you and how much they love you, Lord. Thank you for everyone who's sitting here this morning with us as we've come to worship you. Pray that you'd be with David this morning and be with us as we listen. Give us open hearts and attentive ears and be with David as he speaks. Let it come from you, Lord. And from your word. We love you, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen and amen. Thank you for that scripture and the announcements. Let's all stand up together. We're going to stand up together in Jesus' name. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Amen and amen. So that scripture just hit me because it was going really good for a while and then talked about rebellion. And that's what we do. That's what we do. But he pursues us. He pursues us, and he loves his sons and daughters, and that's who we are, sons and daughters in Christ. Amen?
Lift up your voice and with us
God and King. I not call this world my home.
Praise you. There's no more appropriate song than could be have sung by our worship team for this time of prayer together this morning, especially in light of the way I believe the Lord has been leading me for these messages today and next week. So will you join with me in prayer as we go to our Lord together? Our Father in heaven, as we gather this morning, we're keenly aware of our needs in our lives. And you know, Lord, looking across our congregation and into our hearts, what we need to confess, what we need to get right before you. And we invite your Holy Spirit to come and to do his work of convincing and convicting. Lord, we would ask that you would distance every distraction and every disturbing spirit that might come into our midst this morning. may you have right away. May your Holy Spirit indeed come and fill this place and speak to every one of our hearts. Lord, we have so many needs. We have such a widely diverse congregation, and we have so many needs, but we serve a great God who is able to meet every one of those needs. And we would pray even this morning for our pastor and his wife as they're absent from us and recovering. We ask, Lord, you keep your hand upon them and help them recover quickly and well, thoroughly. Lord, there's many people in our midst who have loved ones, cares and concerns on their hearts, and we would just ask, Lord, that again, you'd meet their needs according to your riches and glory by Christ Jesus. And we pray in his name this morning. Amen. We will take up an offering this morning, but I want to remind you that in the Old Testament, tithes and offerings were composed of the very essence of the life of God's people. And by giving those tithes, that was a symbol that they were trusting in God for their future, for their daily walk, and for their daily needs. So that's what we're doing this morning. As the offering is taken, give of your very best to the Lord in acknowledgement of his gracious provision for us.
For worship time and for offering, we're just going to sing together.
Well, good morning. I want to welcome everyone who's viewing online. And I know there's at least as many viewing online as there are here today. We're grateful for that. I myself have been an online participant, and I have enjoyed the skills and the techniques that our audiovisual people provide for us, and for Derek and Laura and Susan and Larry and Ronnie for their leadership and worship, and for those that alternate in that great worship team, we want to welcome you and thank you for your participation. With apologies to Caleb, after he has done such a fine job with making announcements, I'd like to take guest speaker privileges and make a couple of my own. He does a nice job, doesn't he? I think we should give him some love. Show him your appreciation. Caleb, God bless you, my brother. We do not have a special CCML application that you can use on your cell phone. But before you put your cell phones on church mode this morning, and for those of you at home, I have another suggestion, another option. You could just go online to yourccml.org. And on that home page, there's two links there that are very easy to use. The first one, you could scroll down to the office mail and click on that link, and you can do it now or you can do it later when you get home. But send an appreciation and a get well note to Pastor Paul and First Lady Jenny. On Wednesday, after having a good time with the grandchildren, Paul started to feel poorly, and by Thursday it was confirmed that he had a case of COVID. And so it would be nice of you if you would send him and Jenny a note of encouragement and reassurance of your prayers for his recovery. Now, if you're a visitor, I would suggest you go to that same site, yourccml.org, and go one more link down to the prayer and praise link. And click on that and take a moment to introduce yourselves, giving us your name, address, and any other background information that would be helpful for our connections team to be better able to serve you. If anyone has a praise or prayer note, that would also be an appropriate place to send those along as well. So I think we need to make better use of our website. And so I just encourage and I thank Jerry McAfee, who is not here this morning, for his work that he's done on that, and those that have helped him. I don't know who all has helped him. Excuse me. Now, you can do all that even while I continue these announcements, because I don't know about you, but this is the time of year I really enjoy. You've got Halloween or All Saints celebration. You've got Thanksgiving. You've got Christmas. You've got New Year celebration. We're coming into party time of the year, and this is the time of year I like. And I'm looking forward to an even, I think, more significant celebration for the life of this congregation. That is in April. The April celebration, when the mortgage on this building is going to be paid off by God's grace with his help. And I'm sure there are ideas floating around in Pastor Paul's head about how to celebrate and who to invite to this tangible expression of God's faithfulness to and through this congregation. Between now and then, I think it would be best to prepare us I think it would be best preparation for us to prepare by using the four W's of discipleship: worship, walk, work, and witness. Sincerely engaging in weekly worship, lifting up or valuing our relationship with the triune God, faithfully walking, practicing, or abiding in Christ every day, and when opportunity appears, working and serving the body of Christ, following the one another's of Scripture. And lastly, witnessing or sharing the gospel with everyone to whom the Lord opens the door of opportunity. Now that's the four W's of discipleship: worship, walk, work, and witness. And I just throw that in free of charge. The last time I was invited to fill the pulpit, I spoke on the four touches or evidences of the Holy Spirit in a believer's life. And those four touches were drawn from a devotional called This Day with the Master, written by the late Dennis F. Kenlaw, former president of Asbury University and the longest tenured OMS chairman of the board of OMS, with whom Celia and I were honored to be counted personal friends. Does anybody remember what those four touches were? Pop quiz this morning. One of these is an appetite for the Word of God. One of the great surprises of regeneration or being born from above is that the new birth creates a different hunger, different desire in a believer for reading God's word. Another is the hunger or the desire to pray, to talk with the Lord daily. It's like breathing or like falling in love. You don't go a day without breathing. And when you're really in love with someone, you hardly can go a day without talking to them. And in this case, we're referring to our Lord, and doing so on a daily basis. Another desire is to fellowship with the family of God, the called out ones. That's whom you are, the ecclesia, the called out ones. The church, we may not have a lot in common with each other, with a wide variety of backgrounds, growing up and educational experiences, or even vocations. But the one thing we have in common is the blood-bought relationship in Christ that his salvation brings to every one of us. Another touch, and the fourth touch, or evidence of the Holy Spirit in a believer's life is the spiritual fervor to share the knowledge of the Lord Jesus with others who do not yet know the personal, saving, intimate relationship we enjoy with Christ through his indwelling Holy Spirit. Have you ever noticed how a new convert, a new believer, will have that enthusiastic, effluent, effervescent, overflowing craving to share Christ with their loved ones, their neighbors, co-workers, and others around them? It does every congregation good to welcome new believers because those new believers kind of overflow in their enthusiasm and energy to the rest of us who kind of have grown stale and cold and calm. Anyway, those were the four touches of the Spirit in the life of a believer. Now, people, please forgive me or indulge me if you don't mind. Since I am more of a professor than a preacher, I'm more of a teacher than a prophet. So beginning today and concluding next week with God's help and by his grace, I hope to share with you four negative attitudes towards the Holy Spirit. These are four positions that a believer can take in relationship to God's Holy Spirit. Now, these seeds were once again borrowed from Dr. Kinlaw's Outstanding Mind and Heart. I've gone through his devotional this day with the Master, I think every year since I first got the book, and I can't tell you how many years that is. But every time I go through it, I see something new, or the Holy Spirit percolates in my heart a new idea. And he once told me, he said, David, there's very few people who have original thoughts. And that's why I like to use his ideas. Usually his ideas are fresh and new and vibrant. So these four positions or negative attitudes function like a spiritual staircase that leads one down into discouragement and then defeat and then despair and ultimately can lead to spiritual death. But the good news is they are avoidable, they're correctable, and they're reversible. Once again, by God's grace and with his help. Now, if you would indulge me one more time, let's pray once again. My knees are shaken. Our Father, I stand before these dear folks, a frail, feeble, fallen creature. I need your help. I need you to hide me behind the cross. And may your Holy Spirit rule and overrule. May the meditations of my heart, in the words of your Spirit, flow in and through my message to these dear brothers and sisters in a way that will transform or help strengthen their spiritual lives. Lord, help us never to think for an instant that because we go through the motions of religion, that we have a saving relationship with Jesus Christ. Only by coming to know him in his reality and coming to know him or understand his word, because of that relationship that we find salvation. Then the ritual becomes reality and meaning transforms boring traditions into eternal truth. And this we ask of you this morning in Jesus' name, amen. The scriptures speak of four positions or negative attitudes that a believer can take towards God's Holy Spirit. How am I on time? These originate out of a basic word study on the unique terms used in Scripture that describe dangerous positions that believers can allow themselves to slip into without watching carefully or living a well-balanced and self-disciplined lifestyle. The first word is found in Isaiah 63:10, where the Bible says the Lord's people grieved his Holy Spirit. In Isaiah 63:7 through 10, which Caleb read this morning, it says, I will repeat it again. I will tell of the kindness of the Lord, the deeds for which he is to be praised, according to all the Lord has done for us. Yes, the many good things he's done for Israel, according to his compassion and many kindnesses. He said, surely they are my people, children who will be true to me. So he became their savior. In all their distress, he too was distressed, and the angel of his presence saved them. In his love and mercy, he redeemed them. He lifted them up and carried them all the days of old. Yet, when you read that in Scripture, they rebelled and grieved his Holy Spirit. Now, the Hebrew word used here is atzab. which can express a variety of meanings, such as to cause grief or sorrow, to make angry or sad, to hurt, harm, or injure, to cause pain or distress, to rebel against or displease, and it can even mean to vex or torture. If we freely translate this section from Isaiah, we could say, despite all the gracious acts, yes, the many good things the Lord accomplished in the lives of his people, in all their turmoil, he too was in turmoil. Yet in his love and his mercy, he redeemed them. Yet they chose to displease and distress his spirit. The same sense of displeasure and distress is expressed in Ephesians 4:30. When we read, and do not grieve the Spirit, Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. The Greek word used here is lupeo, which expresses the same meanings as the Old Testament Hebrew word atzab. Cause sorrow, pain, grief of mourning persons, to make angry or sad, to hurt, harm, or injure, to cause pain or distress, and to cause aggravation and affliction. The New Testament International Version exhorts us in this way, and do not grieve the Holy Spirit, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Or we could say, do not cause or bring sorrow to the Holy Spirit. King James Version says, and grieve not the Holy Spirit, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. Or we could say, do not disappoint or distress the Holy Spirit. The Good News Bible, or today's English version, says, and do not make God's Holy Spirit sad. There's something to be said for the Good News translation because it emphasizes the personal character of our relationship with the Holy Spirit. It is possible for us to harm or injure our relationship with the Holy Spirit. A personal relationship has to be very close in order for that kind of grief even to be possible. You can grieve your mother or father. You can grieve your spouse. You can grieve your children. You can grieve a close friend, but you cannot grieve a casual acquaintance. You can offend him or upset him, but you cannot grieve him in the sense that you would cause a deep hurt or personal injury to him like a loved one's life. You can certainly never grieve an enemy. You can make an enemy angry or hostile, but that's not the kind of grief that's indicated here. The word lupeo used here indicates a tender, intimate, and loving relationship within which someone who loves is deeply hurt, injured, or distressed. This is the kind of grief that describes a broken heart. If it's possible to grieve the Holy Spirit in that manner, we need to ask ourselves, what are the things that deeply hurt or distress the Holy Spirit? The Apostle Paul gives some clues in the context of this Ephesians chapter 4. He names at least two things that harm our relationship with God, the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Jesus. In Ephesians chapter 4, he says, in this passage, Apostle Paul says, let each of you speak truth with his neighbor. And then he says, and be not angry. Be angry and do not sin. And here we see the first element that grieves the Holy Spirit is dishonesty. Paul's talking not only of outright lies, but also of the lies we often use to protect our egos. When the truth is shaded just enough to keep ourselves from looking bad, and we know we ought to look bad, we know this is dishonesty. Embellishing the truth in order to appear circumspect is bearing false witness. In other words, we grieve the Holy Spirit by the way we live. In Ephesians 4, 28 through 32, Paul warns us against unwholesome language, bitterness, improper use of anger, brawling or quarreling, and bad attitudes towards others. Losing self-control is another element that grieves the Holy Spirit. Now, this has probably never happened to any of you here, but in our 55 years of marriage together, I have grieved my wife in this way many times over. She's a tender soul, and my unconsciously brusque and bombastic responses directed at her can easily hurt or injure her. She receives them as a personal rebuke. I find that it takes time to restore our relationship. I have to come to her. I have to acknowledge that I've hurt her. and apologize for doing so and ask her forgiveness so that our loving relationship, which we have enjoyed down through the years, is put back on course. And this same thing is true in our relationship with the Holy Spirit. The Spirit of Jesus who resides in us can be grieved. And when we grieve the Holy Spirit, it takes our recognition and confession to receive His forgiveness and restoration so that we can walk day by day in that same level of intimacy that we have enjoyed even when we were first saved and enjoy that joy of our salvation over again. Now, the second of these four negative attitudes that a believer can take towards God's Holy Spirit is found in 1 Thessalonians 5:19, where the Apostle Paul cautions once again. He says, do not quench the Holy Spirit. By warning us not to put out the Spirit's fire, in this context, Paul is saying that we should not ignore or toss aside the spiritual gifts that the Holy Spirit has given us. Sometimes spiritual gifts are controversial, either because of misuse or abuse, and they may cause division in the church. Rather than trying to solve problems, some believers choose to smother their gifts and to just sublimate them. That always impoverishes the church. We should not stifle the Holy Spirit's work in anyone's life, but encourage the full expression of these gifts to benefit the whole body of Christ. But there's more going on here than just stifling of spiritual gifts. Paul is going further and higher in this reference. The word quench is also used in the Old Testament in numerous places. We'll read just one verse from Isaiah 1:31, which says, the mighty man will become tinder and his work a spark, and both will burn together with no one to quench the fire. The Hebrew word here, used here, is kabah, which can express a variety of meanings such as to forestall, to prevent, to extinguish, to put out, to stomp out, to snuff out, or smother. Now, this passage is found in the early part of Isaiah's prophecy against the people of God who have violated the covenant. And Isaiah is warning that God's judgment will not be stayed or forestalled or short-circuited. Isaiah is saying, you've broken the covenant and the coming judgment is inevitable. It will not be extinguished. It will not be put out. It will not be smothered. It will not be quenched. Now we go from that fire to another fire in the New Testament. In Acts chapter 2, I'm going to just read some excerpts from Acts chapter 2. And if you have your Bibles, turn there with me. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly a sound like a blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now, why the appearance of tongues of fire? Well, tongues, of course, symbolizes speech and the communication of the gospel. And fire symbolizes God's purifying presence, which burns away the undesirable elements or characteristics of our lives and sets our hearts aflame to ignite the lives of others. And we read on, verse 5, Now they were staying in Jerusalem, God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment because each one heard their own language being spoken. Verse 12, amazed and perplexed, they asked one another, what does this mean? Verse 14, and then Peter stood up with the 11, and he raised his voice and he addressed the crowds. He said, fellow Jews, all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain to you. Verse 22, fellow Israelites, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did among you through him, as you yourselves know. This man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death because it was impossible for death to keep a hold on him. Verse 29, fellow Israelites, verse 32, God has raised this Jesus to life and we are all witnesses of it. exalted to the right hand of God. He has received from the Father the promised Holy Spirit and has poured out what you see and hear. Now on Mount Sinai, God confirmed the validity of the Old Testament law with a fire from heaven. Look at Exodus chapter 19, verses 16 through 18. Here at Pentecost, God once again confirms the validity of the Holy Spirit's ministry by sending fire. At Mount Sinai, fire had come down in one place. At Pentecost, fire came down on many believers, symbolizing God's presence is now available to all who believe in him. Verse 36, therefore let all Israel be assured of this, God has made this Jesus whom you crucified both Lord and Messiah. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, brothers, what shall we do? Peter replied, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord God, our Lord God, will call. And with many other words, he warned them and pleaded with them, save yourselves from this corrupt generation. Those who accepted his message were baptized, and there were about 3,000 new believers added to the church that day. The church was born on Pentecost with the coming of the Holy Spirit of Jesus in fulfillment of his previous promise. And the Holy Spirit gave purifying life and a powerful breath of witness to the church on Pentecost. The tongues of fire that rested upon the disciples' heads and a fire that was kindled in their hearts, it became a blaze in the hearts of the disciples. And that fire, the gospel transformation, began to spread throughout the then known world. But after a few years, the Apostle Paul cautioned the early church, his fellow believers, about the second attitude that one can take towards the Holy Spirit described in 1 Thessalonians 5:19. Do not quench the Holy Spirit. Only a fire can be quenched. John the Baptist's words about Jesus was that he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. On Pentecost, the Spirit came in purifying power, and this baptism of the fire occurred. A fire comes to a person's soul when that believer is filled with the Spirit, and there comes a passionate burning desire to know Christ and to make him known. An ignited person with an ignited heart is the one baptized by the Spirit's fire or totally infilled by the Holy Spirit. However, that raging, beautiful fire of devotion can be extinguished. The Greek word used here, spenoumi, means to extinguish or quench or put out or go out, to suppress, stifle, or smother. It even sounds like a fire being put out. If you pronounce the hard B like an Indian would with a V sound, or a Russian would with a V sound, it says, just listen to it, spenoumi. That sounds like something putting out a fire. The Apostle Paul declares it's possible to douse the fire that burns within, to reduce the raging flame that burns brightly in your soul until all that remains is a cold, dark cinder. Where there was once warmth and light, there is now only coldness and death. What are the two things? What are the things that squelch or diminish the Holy Spirit's zeal or the fire of devotion in our lives? It's very interesting here in 1 Thessalonians 5:19 that Paul does not say what they are. He just emphasizes not to do it. But we know a fire is quenched when water is poured on it. And in our lives, sin is the water that quenches the Spirit and ultimately puts out the Spirit's flame. We know there are sins of commission, that is, knowing what to do and not doing it anyway, and doing it anyway. This is what our life care group is studying, a book by Nancy Lee DeMoss called Holiness. And this is what Nancy Lee DeMoss calls in her book, the sewage of our lives, the willful, blatant transgression and presumptuous sins. We know there are sins of commission. We also know there are sins of omission. That is knowing what we ought to do and then not doing it. These are the situations when we can become undercover CIA Christians. We let complacency, indifference, and apathy settle into our lives, and we do nothing when we should be doing something. This is what the Old Testament called sins of ignorance. And even they required a sacrifice. Then there is the sin that douses the fire of relationships, and that is misplacing our priorities in maintaining our relationship with the Lord Jesus. Again, Nancy Lee DeMoss says, in effect, soul maintenance is like a two-sided coin and involves putting off and putting on. And she refers to, and I have referred to, Colossians chapter 3 as a great chapter that explains what to put off and what to put on. I pretty much lived in this chapter overseas. I would encourage you to take some time this afternoon, do yourself a favor, and read and meditate upon Colossians chapter 3 and memorize some verse that sticks out to you as you read it. Just memorize it. The Holy Spirit would want you to hide that in your heart. Now, God called me into cross-cultural career missionary service. Eventually, He even led me into an assignment where my spiritual gifts of evangelism, faith, vision, administration, strategic thinking, and accountability resulted in maximizing our missional fruit in evangelism and discipleship, church planning and development, and in theological education and leadership development, with the result that we reached never before documented and verified accomplishments throughout the mission. Now, when the time came for me to step aside, I began to slightly and silently complain. Said, Lord, what will become of me? I'll no longer be respected because of my position or possess any official status. What will give me my significance? Where will I gain my sense of self-worth and dignity once again? Or will I just fade away into obscurity or anonymity, never to be recognized for what you did through me and my co-workers during our tenure as leadership? How rude was that of me to say? The Lord replied to my quiet lament. He said, oh, which is it that you love, me or my ministry? Where have you been finding your sense of significance before this? Where were you when I called you to serve me? It's kind of like the Lord's reply to Job. Where were you when I cast the stars across the heaven? You pipsqueak. Eventually, I found that I could say, Lord, you are my love. Take my ministry, take my position, take my prestige and anything you want. You alone are the source of my joy and my salvation. And I have enjoyed His calling that He entrusted to me for the cause of Christ around the world. But He is so much richer than His ministry. And it's that personal relationship with Him through the Holy Spirit that is the most important relationship in my life. And I began to realize that we are more than what we do. Especially men hear that. We are more than what we do. Jesus gives me my sense of self-worth and identity. My sense of self-worth is only in Him and not in what I do on a daily basis. Now, this is the reason the Holy Spirit is so important in our lives. It is He who bears witness to Christ. It is He who glorifies Christ. He makes us conscious of things in our lives that are displeasing, distressing, and downright defiling to Jesus. And He brings our repentant hearts into conformity with the pattern of the purity of Jesus. But we must be filled with the Holy Spirit. in order that we may not grieve the Lord or quench his Holy Spirit, so that Jesus Christ may find delight in us as we find the fullness of our delight in him. It is a Christ-centered life to which God calls us, and it is the Spirit of Christ who makes it possible. What makes it possible for someone to be living in intimacy with God and then lose that intimacy? I believe it's a matter of inner choices which determines all personal relationships. Now, I have several reflection questions for you to meditate upon this morning. Is he your delight? Is he your raison d'etre? Is the Spirit of Christ the focal point around which your life revolves? Are you living in such close, intimate relationship with the Holy Spirit that it makes displeasure, distress, or personal injury an impossibility? Is there anything in your heart that you need to make right? Is he grieved with you? As a great preacher once said, when the Spirit grieves, he leaves. If the glory of the Lord has departed, do not wait another minute before you make amends. Lastly, is your life white hot with the fire of the Spirit, or have you let that fire be put out? Celia says, we can be distracted to death in our Western Disney world of faith. Draw close to him today, and he will reignite that fire in your heart and life. And now I'm going to close in prayer. Thank you for your attention this morning and putting up with this bubbling, babbling fool that stands before you. Father God, we tend to hurt those whom we love the most. And worst of all, so often it is you that we hurt through our grievous actions or our ignorant avoidance and faltering faith when we should be leaning on you. Help us, O Lord, to avoid grieving you or any of those we most love this week. Help us through your abiding Holy Spirit to quicken our innermost being and to alert us to your presence in our lives so that we don't grieve, much less quench your Holy Spirit. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Next week, with God's help and by his grace, I hope to conclude this mini-series with two more steps on that staircase that will impact us in our daily relationship with the Holy Spirit. Now, as always, please feel free to remain in your seats and or come kneel at the altar if you have any spiritual housekeeping that you feel necessary to do with God while others quietly depart the sanctuary. But those who walk out that door, I bet you've not stopped to look and see what that slogan says right there on that mantelpiece. Go out to love and serve. We can't slap that. I can't jump that high, that's for sure, and I don't think any of you can. Like an athletic team going out to the field of battle. But you can make that commitment in your heart, and I challenge you to make it your commitment this week by God's grace and with his Holy Spirit's help.
Thank you, David. We're going to light up some words of the song we opened up with, and that's how we're going to exit, okay? Please stand with us.
Run into wide open spaces, graces, waiting for you. Dance like the way it has been planted.
If you want, be blessed. Take what we learned today out into the world.
The Spirit of the Lord, there is freedom. There is freedom. The Spirit of the Lord, there is freedom. There is freedom. Come out of the dark, just as you are. Enter the fullness of His love.
Yeah.
From wherever you've been,